And then what we were learning from Detroit was like the whole sort of Chicago Detroit sound that really wasn't so featured in what was happening in Toronto at the time.
Hallo ihr Lieben, willkommen bei der zweiten Ausgabe von Warmup Berlin. Ich bin die Isabel und ich freue mich, dass ihr heute dabei seid. Denn wir quatschen hier ein bisschen über Kultur, ein paar geile Beats und die Geschichte der Musik. Und in diesem Sinne freue ich mich total, heute DJ, Produzent und Label-Owner Mike Shannon begrüßen zu dürfen. Hey Mike,
hello.
Lovely to have you here tonight. You're good?
Yeah, you know, just getting warmed up, getting ready for the evening.
Yeah, yeah. Ready for the evening. I hope you guys too. And yeah, Mike, I can remember we had our last proper session together shortly before the lockdown started in February.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it was when you played for my party at Watergate.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, it was.
Who could forget that?
it was amazing. It was amazing. And I can...
Good times.
It was good. Yeah, it was really good times. And I can remember a pretty funny story in there, because for you to know, like, Mikey played the last slot at the party. And of course, at some point, the night manager came to me and was like, okay, Isabel, it's time to stop. We're running really late. We have 5 minutes left. So please check that the DJ is going to play the last record. The fact was, I don't want it to stop. You don't want it to stop. And also the people on the dance floor.
Oh, now I'm remembering a bit. So we extended this a little bit, right?
We went for a little extension.
Well, that's the thing, you know, that's your job, really. You know, anyone that just backs off from that at that point, you know, you gotta try at least. If you don't try.
Okay, you really smashed it, because Mike, when I told him that we have to stop in 5 minutes, he put on a 20 minutes record.
All right, that's how I did it. That's a sneaky way.
Yeah, it was. I mean, the night manager, he hated us.
Oh my God, yeah. I've had a few situations like that where things get pretty...
I loved it, Mike, like really.
But you gotta go for it. I mean, that's part of just your job to keep it going as long as you can, you know. It's all kind of a game. Everybody has to sort of understand that. Any night managers that take it personally, they're in the wrong line of work, I think.
I think they had no choice.
Yeah, they must have to deal with that sometimes.
Yeah, it's true. But yeah, good memories. Hope we have some more of them soon.
Yeah, I hope so too.
Yeah.
Here we go.
But yeah, Mike, let's talk about your history.
Going back in time.
You were born in Canada.
Yes.
So how was it for you to grow up over there?
Yeah, it was good. I mean, really, you know, when you think about growing up in Canada, it's really like, you know, like an unbelievably privileged kind of place to be growing up. You know, things work really, really well, you know, everything in terms of like, you know, things are quite, you know, balanced and easy over there, you know. And there's lots of people coming in from all over the place, like where I grew up. There was a lot of people from almost every culture in the world there, like, you know, it's
amazing.
Really a special place. Well, specifically like in the region where I grew up, which is just, it's about like an hour outside of Toronto and a couple of hours away from Detroit, kind of southern Ontario. And yeah, you know, it's a really easy, you know, really privileged place to grow up.
Yeah, sounds good. I meant to have like a mixed bag full of friends coming from all over the place means also like mixed music from all over the
place. Yeah, exactly. Totally. Yeah. So you have like a lot of influences coming from everywhere, you know?
It
really works nicely that way. You get a lot of positive influences, especially like for whatever radio and things like that we were growing up with. There was so much diversity.
Great. You know? Yeah. We will get some insights in the second part of the show. So I can't wait for it. Like, listen to a few of your most and biggest influences. And you also worked in an all-age club when you were like 12, 13 mm-hmm. years old. And there's also a really funny story behind. I mean, it's the story how you became a DJ, isn't
it? Well, kind of, yeah. So like it started off, you know, I was, me and a couple of friends were sort of, me and my best friend really were sort of busboys at this place. So we were sort of cleaning up tables and doing stuff and sort of preparing things at the beginning of the night. And there was a DJ, the resident DJ, this is like whatever, all ages, Sunday nights or whatever, or something like that. And the DJ that was working there, we kind of had a little bit of a relationship. And often what happened with him is that he would be like late showing up. And I kind of knew what I was doing with the booth in there and everything. We used to bug him all the time to play our records. And he would always do that for us at the beginning of the night. Because it was like whatever, you know, kind of like early rave records that we wanted to listen to and stuff. And it was, he was playing, it was sort of happening at the time where he was sort of sneaking that stuff in, but we were putting pressure on him to play more of that, those kind of things. And then when he would play that stuff, we would get up on stage and sort of like dance for everybody, do this crazy go-go dancing sort of thing. And sometimes we would have like, whatever, like alternate masks on and stuff like that, and have our kind of outfits that we were doing. So we were sort of like, we were working there, but we would also, when that would happen, we were sort of like
crazy rave kids,
the go-go dancers kind of came in for like the rave, the 20-minute rave session, you know what I mean? That's kind of what would happen there. And it was, you know, and eventually that started happening more and more often. More and more people were really kind of excited about that sort of thing happening. And then it just kind of turned into him playing like way more of that music. So I used to come in, bring records and stuff. And then at some certain points, he would let me play the records at the beginning of the night or whatever. And just he would take a little break and then I would do that, you know, and that was kind of happening. But the thing was actually that I didn't really like that part of it so much at the time. I really wanted to be dancing on this. I wanted to be on the podium. Like that's, I didn't want to be in the booth playing them. I wanted to be up there like showing off my moves.
I feel
and
you.
And whatever. And then it was kind of, it was a riot. But that's kind of how that sort of familiarity with the DJ booth, that's probably where it really first happened, like that.
Yeah, but how you were able to take over the turntables in the age of 12 or 13 years old, I mean.
Because I already had a little, I was really into it already, had a little setup of my own. And then he, when we were going in there, that's how I had the relationship with him, and he was sort of like, we knew that I knew what I was doing in there with that, and that's kind of how that happened. But it was quite, you know, casual thing. It wasn't like I was taking over the DJ and DJing all night or something like that. It was very not like that at all. It was like little break time for him or something.
But you were super young. I mean, be able to mix with 12 or 13 years old. It's,
I still had a long way to go with mixing and all that stuff at that point. You know, I knew how to play the records, but it wasn't like, wasn't up there doing anything crazy, you know. There was no like double copies and scratching and anything like that, you know. Just hit play. But anyway, those things, you know, evolved over time, and that's kind of where it would be sort of begun.
Really lovely story. Mm-hmm. And you also mentioned that you lived like 2 hours away from Detroit. How was it for you to be a part of the big rush in Detroit during that time?
We were, again, like really lucky, amazing timing to be around there at that time, you know. It's like, it was a really unique point in time when things were really exploding there in the 90s. And we used to go down there quite often, maybe once a month, maybe once every 2 months, where we were going down and driving across the border as kids. And like that was a mega, it was a crazy thing for us, you know, because like, you know, going to those kind of parties in Toronto, it was a way different sort of feeling that you had there. When you cross the border into Detroit, it's a whole like sense of fear that would just sort of creep in, and just your hair would sort of stand up when you're over there, because this was like a different world, you know, compared to what we were used to. Like you literally cross the river and it's night and day. And at that time, especially, it was like, you know, it wasn't exactly the safest thing to be 16 years old, 15, running around to warehouse parties there. It was pretty crazy at the time, you know, but that was like half of the essence of the whole thing, what made it so exciting at that time was that, you know. And then of course the style of music and everything at those parties was completely, totally different thing that was happening in Toronto. So Toronto really had this UK influence more than anything else there for a lot of the those kind of parties that were happening there. And then what we were learning from Detroit, and it was like the whole sort of Chicago Detroit sound that really wasn't so featured in what was happening in Toronto at the time. So we were in getting the best of both worlds there. And, you know, we were like years later, we're crossing the border all the time too to buy records. So I was working for a record shop and doing orders and stuff for that shop. And we used to drive across the border. And I was doing this kind of border runs, you know, maybe once a month that we'd be doing that. So the whole trip down there was always like, okay, there was that part of it, and then we'd be able to kind of do some partying and stuff like that too, and then jump in the van and come back with all these records.
It's,
yeah.
It sounds so lovely, man. Amazing. Yeah, but after a while, I mean, okay, you enjoyed it. You had a proper amazing time. Mm-hmm. But after a while, you decided to leave Canada because you realized that there was much more going on in Europe and Germany.
Yeah.
So when and when was your first trip to Germany?
So then? The first trip to Germany that I had, I guess it would have been in 2000, I think, mm-hmm. or 99, mm-hmm. could have been. And I was coming over to play in Dusseldorf at this club. It was called Ego. It was the original Ego club there. And it was kind of funny that the people were saying that it was the best club in Cologne. But it wasn't in Cologne, it was in Dusseldorf. So that was the big joke about the whole thing like that. So yeah, anyway, that was the first tour that I was doing. Well, actually, that would have been the second tour that I did already, but that was the first time that I played in Germany, was this one. And I was touring together with Jeff Milligan, and I remember it was really funny when we were arriving there, and it was really like, this club, Jeff was really nervous about it, because it was like this kind of highbrow, sort of like snobby, sort of minimal scene that was there, and he was explaining it all to me, and I didn't really know so much about the whole thing. Anyway, we're getting there to the train station, the promoter's picking us up, and she's like, oh yeah, Jeff, and big hugs from Jeff, and she's like, well, where's Mike? And I'm like, what? And me right here, is like, what? Like, it's you? Like, Mike? But you're so young, like, what's going on? They were expecting that I was some big black guy or something, you know what I mean? That, which has always been something that happened to me many times. We're like, it's you? Like, really, like, always shocked. But this time, it was like, I think I was 20 years old at the time when I was coming over there. So yeah, I looked pretty young. And the girl was like, oh, wow. She's like, you're the youngest person to ever play the club. And you're the youngest person to ever enter the club. And I was like, okay. Great. Okay. It's a little intimidating now.
Big compliment, huh?
Yeah, anyway, it was a crazy, what an amazing place. It was so cool, so many levels. And then it was like meeting some people for the first time through that gig that, okay, like first guy that I met when we were hanging out there with these guys was Florian Schneider from Kraftwerk. Wow. So he's sitting there, and I was already, when that happened, I was kind of like a little bit, oh my God, like what's going on? He was sort of sitting across the way that the sound was set up. It was Monolake, Robert Henke, that did the sound system of this place. And it had, was super freaky for me because there was no, you had to plug the headphones. You didn't plug the headphones into the mixer. You plugged them into a delay unit because the stacks were facing at you like this, pointing at you. And the way that Robert had done it is he calculated the distance, whatever, divided by the speed of sound or whatever, and that gave you the delay time to plug into this delay unit, which gave you perfect reference. So you could just play off the sound system without any latency or any delays or anything. So this was already, I was kind of scared about messing up because of this. I've never seen that before. It's crazy. And then meeting Robert Henke, meeting people like this, it was crazy.
What an honor.
First experience in Germany for me. It was really an amazing place. Yeah. But don't be confused with the one that they did an Ego club later that I think it was in Hamburg. Oh, that there's another club, the same name. But anyway, don't confuse that, fans, kids. Okay, let's get this straight.
and you went more often to that club?
It was it was only around for maybe 2 years or something, or 3 years. Mm-hmm. And yeah, that was the only time that I was touring around, and it was the only time I made it in there. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Wow. And you also told me before, I can't remember when, that you were pretty young, mm-hmm. and you were a huge fan of Ricardo Villalobos.
Oh, yeah, indeed. Sure.
Mm-hmm. And then there was a situation where you entered a club and Ricardo was playing and you didn't know that he plays.
So that was funny. That was in Dusseldorf again.
Again?
So I was
okay.
coming back another time, I think maybe a year later, or coming back to Dusseldorf, and I was staying with Andy Vass, and he was doing a really, really cool label at the time. It was called Background Records. And we were always staying with him. He was sort of hooking us up with all that stuff. And I remember there was this, there was a Villalobos record, a Playhouse one, that I was like, wow, like this guy's gonna be the bomb. This is so like next level, totally into it. Explaining that to Andy, and he's like, I've never heard of this guy, whatever, who's this? And then we were going for a drink at this club there, and it was like, again, like a Sunday night thing. And he was playing there. So I was like, holy shit, yeah, wow. So I went, like, introduced myself, and he had some of my records in his bag there. He was like, really? And he was more embarrassed about the scene where he was booked to play. he was really embarrassed that we were kind of catching him there. It wasn't like a really nice club per se, you know. It was like, wasn't happens. A good thing, but he was a little bit embarrassed about that whole thing. And anyway, that was the beginning of the connection that I had with those guys, would have been there. And then I was coming to Berlin to hang out like the following week after that. So then I ended up hanging out with all those guys here. And that was the beginning of that whole connection. That's kind of how that connection happened.
Awesome.
Yeah.
What an honor. Yeah, you're a fan of somebody and then you're entering a club. And
yeah, it was cool. I was surprised. I was shocking. I didn't know.
Your records.
I didn't think that would be the case, that anyone really was aware of what we were up to so much over there. But it sort of makes sense that he would have known that. But at the time, I was really shocked.
So there was a connection already. Amazing. Mm-hmm. And I mean, yeah, you're living in Berlin since a really long time.
Yeah, it's been a while now. Yeah.
It's been a while.
Yeah.
How many years now?
Oof. Yeah, like swift. Yeah, I want to say 10 years,
okay,
or more.
And what do you still love about Berlin, and what do you hate about Berlin?
Oh, I still love about Berlin that you can still be like a mega freak and no one cares about this. And it's like one of those things where you can, you know, you can walk. I can go grocery shopping in my boxer shorts, and it's not going to be a problem. You know what I mean? It's no big deal.
Nobody cares.
Yeah,
it's just a normal, you know, casual.
You're living
Wednesday.
In some other cities, and it's really like, oh my God, you're wearing that outside? Like, you know, it's like it's kind of like there's kind of things that exist in a lot of other places that really doesn't exist here.
Yeah, it's true.
You know?
I know what you mean.
And then what I don't like, whatever, it's just like it's slowly becoming just like everywhere else in a way, you know, like just the years that I've been here. And I remember getting, when I arrived here, it was already like, Berliners were like, well, it's over. You late. You
know,
what are you doing?
The Berliners,
yeah.
Like, hey,
yeah. Yeah, you're the reason why it's over.
Yeah.
No, I'm just kidding. No, sorry.
Yeah.
But anyway. You know, anyway, so yeah, that would be it, you know, it's like, you can see it sort of like slowly coming, you know, becoming like just like everywhere else, really, or any other city in Germany. Really.
Unfortunately, yeah.
Yeah, but anyway, let's see. I think things now, it's like, you know, it looks like things are going to be kind of reborn in a new way anyway, after all this stuff gets cleaned up and we sort of emerge from the pandemic here, you know,
let's
see what it's gonna be like, you know. And I guess nobody really has a clue how that's really gonna be.
Maybe,
you know,
a little
but
revolution.
Hopefully it will be better for the best.
Yeah, I agree. I have also the feeling that we have a huge change in Berlin already in the last years. Oh yeah, I mean, long time before I arrived here, of course, I know. But no, like the feeling I had the last years, like that,
the
clubs has to close and they get rid of old super nice buildings, all the graffiti, all like the urban, the cool Berlin stuff, and now it's like huge buildings and all the unnecessary shit nobody
needs.
For
me, it was the first place that I played in Berlin, and it was thanks to Sammy D from Perlon, was the guy who invited me to play with him at Osgood. And I was 21 years old when I got invited to play in there. And that was the first gig that I had in Berlin, was this one. And I was like, I had no idea anything about what this was or anything. And I remember the first time that he was, like, it was like maybe a year before or something like that, that I was in town. I was in Berlin for the first time when I was hooking up with those guys.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm in Berlin for the first time. He's like, yeah, come down. And there's a really cool night. Rob Hood is playing. And it's going to be really cool. I'll put you on the list and everything. So, and then I'm getting there. So I'm getting on the list and I'm getting there to the door and I'm getting inside. And it's 1,000 guys, shirts off, leather pants. Like, and it was like, holy shit. I was like fresh meat on a stick in there. Like really, holy fuck. Because that's the thing, you know, you're experiencing the gay thing in Toronto, Ontario.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, but it's like, you know, it's like Madonna, sort of like drag queens and like, it was nowhere near this kind of like intensity like this. I don't think in the world I'd ever saw anything like that.
Yeah.
And it was like, that blew my mind. So I lasted probably, it was too much. Like I really couldn't handle all the attention I was getting in there. So I lasted about 2 hours. And I had to go. I couldn't do it. It was just it was too much for me. Like I was getting attacked in there. It was crazy. But it was really like
it's history, man.
Yeah, that was a really like big one for me, was that. And then so then I was like months later was playing there. And that was an amazing first, you know, the icebreaker, and just like an honor to be involved in that, you know.
to be there at that time, you know. And you're looking at it all now, like, it's like, there it is, like, whatever, Mercedes-Benz Arena, that's where it used to be, and like all that stuff is, it's like a different world now.
Yeah. You know?
But that's where that was. So yeah, it's interesting to see how the transformation. So I think, like, I mean, according to some of those people, already sort of missed the boat there. But at that time, you know, it was still a lot different than what it is today.
Yeah.
And it was like, even that place, like, when you think about how much more extreme it was as, like, anything goes place compared to, like, what Panorama Bar came after, it was like completely night and day in terms of, like, you know, there was never the feeling that you had any rules holding you back at all. So yeah.
So I would say our mission is now to keep the unique and the special vibe alive, and who knows what comes afterwards. But as you said, maybe like a revolution, or we will fight for it, definitely.
You know.
So we will come out of the crisis like even stronger. But also about the topic work, you worked on a pretty nice project because you announced your new album last month.
Yeah, so there's a new album that I've been working on sort of on and off for a while, and it's kind of like a soundtrack to a story that it was actually the way I wanted to do it was like a soundtrack to a film that doesn't exist, and the way I wanted to sort of promote it was to promote the whole thing as if it was a film.
Mm-hmm.
And do it that way, this really sort of over-the-top sort of science fiction movie. So it has like a whole lot of big drama and sort of cinema, sort of full string arrangements and this kind of cinema style things. And there's like some pretty hyper sound design and futuristic stuff that goes along in there. But yeah, it's definitely like in terms of music, it's probably the deepest thing I've done that way.
And I teamed
up with a friend of mine in Montreal. She plays for Godspeed Black Emperor, and that's like a kind of a famous jam band from Montreal, and she's a genius, and she was doing the string parts and stuff. Like, I wrote some of the arrangements and everything in there, and then we were sort of working long distance. She was recording all the cello and violin and stuff that's going in there, so it really has that sort of cinema feeling, and I'm excited about it. It's cool. It's one of those things that I put a lot of energy into over the years, and I think it's been like perfect timing for that to finally see the light now.
It's a great idea, and it's super different. Yeah.
And then there's like also we've been working on, so I've been writing the story that goes along with there's the stories there.
Awesome. Uh-huh.
And what I wanted to do was like for the vinyl release of this was to have sort of like a glimpse of that story in there. It's going to be kind of an illustrated gatefold that has like kind of sort of key sections of each thing that there's basically an illustration for each song that's there, so the whole thing's kind of like a mini graphic novel when you open it up. And then the idea eventually, you know, it would be to publish it as a full graphic novel with this illustrator called Julia Zah that's here in Berlin.
Oh yeah, Julia.
Yeah,
she's great.
Yeah,
she's done
fantastic.
A good job. Oh, then
so yeah, that
it's
was
a match.
That was the idea. So anyway.
So I would love to get some insights of the album now in the second part of the show where we have our listening session.
Sure, maybe we can listen to some.
Yeah? Yeah, Mike, really interesting interview. Thank you to share all that stories with us.
My
and
pleasure.
I would say we go to the second room.
Okay,
and enjoy your music.
All right.
Okay, also ihr Lieben, wir gehen jetzt mal rüber und ich hoffe, ihr habt den ersten Teil genossen und dann geht's jetzt mal weiter. Nächste Runde. Bis gleich.
And this was really like what was going on down there was like a raw thing. It was like a really, it was an acid thing, basically, to be honest with you.
Okay, hon, let's show us what you brought for us. I'm really excited about it.
Cheers.
Let's do it. Sounds lovely already. I found it really nice that you're starting with a jazz record.
Well, you know, that's where it started. So like this is going to be chronological.
Yeah, playlist. So that's the beginning.
From the beginning.
Okay. So you listened to it when you were a kid?
So yeah, my father was a big influence on me when it comes to jazz and blues music. And we're listening to Ahmad Jamal, it's called Taboo. And this was recorded in 1958 in Chicago. And me, without even knowing it, this is probably my first influence of what was going on in Chicago at the time.
I love it. Great.
So it's the record of your father? Because, I mean, you must be really young during that time.
So yeah, I mean, I think I wasn't aware of what I was listening to at this time. And yeah, obviously, there were so many things that was under the influence from not really realizing it until I was inheriting those records. And really, then I was really starting to really appreciate what was happening then. But this would have been one of the first ones.
Mm-hmm. Really nice.
Tempo is going crazy.
Yeah,
right?
No.
Yeah. All right. Oh yeah, so that was the first one.
Lovely intro.
Yeah, I mean, jazz always had like a mega influence on what I was doing. And we're gonna do this thing like chronologically, like I was saying. So we're gonna make a bit of a jump here just to kind of keep the energy.
Okay,
alive.
Okay, of course.
So this is really like, so that was my father's influence. Now this is my mother's influence.
Okay.
Which is like mm-hmm. a little bit more fun somehow in some ways, you know. So we're gonna step next to Giorgio Moroder. We're gonna pick it up a lot. So we're moving to 1982 now.
Classic.
This is a major year for me. I mean, there's so many records I'm going to play in the next that were like... So then I was born in 78, so that would have been 4 years old. Just sort of getting my dance moves started.
Yeah, that's how you improve your dancing skills, huh? So your mom, she was dancing to it at home?
Yeah, my mom was a major influence on that whole side of things, like where we're gonna go the next couple. And Giorgio Moroder obviously like was so advanced on so many levels when it came down to synthesizers and things like this. It was like really like the first time that I was ever, not even realizing it at the time, but this was gonna shape a whole lot of things were gonna happen later.
Okay, so one of your first contacts with synthesizers then?
I mean, this guy was really pioneering a lot of that sound that so many people were after afterwards.
It's the favorite of one of my friends. He will freak out when he sees it.
Yeah, that's your chance. You can make a shout out. Shout out to Ray Ray. Here, this record's for him.
Shout out to Marcos.
One thing I love about this record, there's a thing, it's called E equals MC squared. And there's one song where he actually gives the kit list of what he's using to make all the different sounds. So he's got a vocoder on his voice. We're not listening to that right now, but it's one of the tracks on the record that where he breaks down every single instrument that he's using. And he's got a vocoder on his voice. So he's giving the whole kit list of what's being played and what's doing what.
Hit list.
It's
okay.
So cool.
Okay, cool.
Should we move on, or are we?
However
keep
you
going?
Feel like.
So you're imagining like a 4 year old walking around with his mom in the sun. Anyway.
Right.
I'm sure right my mom on. Is Thanks, also Giorgio. Dancing at home, actually.
Well, like, Giorgio touched so many people. That he was the man. What do you think? Was Giorgio Moroder Italian or German? I'm asking you.
Like, really? I have no fucking clue, to be honest.
Good question, right? We don't have to answer that.
Tell me why. No, you bring it up.
Well, I think he was always in Munich, so I wasn't sure if he was German or if he was an Italian guy.
I mean, he looks Italian.
There's one thing that's for sure is that Rick James.
Oh.
He wasn't from Munich, that's for sure. Rose petal daiquiri. I got something good about that.
Good choice.
Okay, should we keep going with 1982?
I'm super into it, yeah. Just keep the ball rolling.
Yeah, I mean, nobody really, everybody wanted to be Rick James, I think, at that point. Everybody. I mean,
everybody.
Like, let's just take a look. I mean, you know,
yeah,
I mean,
it's just
damn.
Like, wow. That's unbelievable.
Can you put that away for me here?
Okay.
Okay, so
I will do
like
it for you.
Yeah, let's go. We're gonna go
Motel.
With some more 1982. We're gonna go with some Zap.
Amazing.
And I mean, Zap basically made Dr. Dre's record. Like his whole career was made on Zap. You know, like all that like West Coast, West Side gangster stuff wouldn't exist wasn't this.
You were also anyway. Super into that West Coast.
I'm not saying
Coast
I'm a
stuff?
Gangster now because I
yeah,
listen to
come that. On. You are, I know it, I
oh,
know
yeah.
it. I will keep it as a secret. I mean, everybody hears now, but I will say nothing. So you were also really into that West Coast shit or?
Well, you know. I mean, I think I was a lot, but I was not even aware that I was under the influence, you know?
Okay.
I was just the records that I grew up with. It's not
yeah.
my fault. Don't, I mean, my East Coast friends
I mean,
don't,
your
don't
parents,
hate.
They did an amazing job, like, really.
Yeah, there was a lot of
good
fun dance
you.
Parties at home.
Yeah, I can imagine.
So, the thing that's really special about Zap is what he's using here. It's a special instrument. It's called a talk box.
A talk box.
You hear
box.
His vocals? Listen.
Yeah.
It's an instrument called a talk box. So you sort of sing in, it's like a tube. You sing into it and it's like a keyboard that you're playing on this.
Oh.
And it's like, gives you this really incredible, it's not a vocoder sound.
No,
it's
no,
a special
no, it's really
vocal
old fashioned.
Thing. And these guys were the pioneer of that whole funk sound like wow. this was Zap. And that, for me, it was always like super futuristic funk sound. Nobody
it
else
is.
Was able to get come close to that.
Wow, super interesting.
Everybody sampled it and imitated it. Everybody. Even Rick James. Okay, let's go to another one.
That's a great choice.
Okay.
Great choice.
So we're still in the same kind of.
Wow, that's like really a musical
journey. It's a lot of records
journey.
I have from that year, from 82. And this
82?
Next one.
82?
This is on a German label,
oh,
Harvest
which one?
Records. And this is Thomas Dolby.
I'm going to go with Shibanami with science, just keep the tempo up here. And one of my favorite things ever. This really was like me playing with my dinky cars and toys and stuff, 4 years old. And I used to put this record on the turntable so that I could have this kind of like, you know, little like fantasy play zone that was happening there. With this is the soundtrack to like what was going on there.
And you,
my toys.
And you put it on.
I would be putting
like
on.
Like with 4 years.
Yeah. Nice. This is the one. No idea what he was talking about.
Can perform it so well, so well. I just imagine you playing with the cars, man. And then like.
So I was always like really thinking that this is one of the like instruments that he was using years later. It's just like some piece of technology there. It's not actually what he was using. But the sound design, like what he was doing in this record was like so insane. It was like amazing. I love this thing. And this is like still trying to figure out how he did some of these sounds here.
Are you still trying? You didn't sound out yet?
This still influences like, I love what the whole record is so amazing. Anyway, that's the most popular, like, fun one. But anyway, let's keep moving on here.
I love it.
Man, we need another turntable here. We can master mix this thing. Like, wow. If there's ever been a call for a master mix,
I will keep it in mind.
Okay, so here we go. So now we're going to step into more of an underground thing. And this is Royal House. And this is like maybe one of the most.
Oh, it's one of my favorites. I love it.
Everybody copied this record at one point. I don't know if you heard it. Like, okay, like a great example is like Technotronic.
Yeah, yeah. So
all these, like, everyone sampled these chords, the same ones that are coming up here.
But this is amazing.
And Todd Terry was the man. He did it.
Which year was it again?
Huh?
Which year?
This is shit.
Yeah, we can have a look afterwards. It's so good.
It must be 80. It must be 84.
84.
85. That's the chords I'm talking about.
Yeah, of course. Yeah. Now dancing in a club when it's already daylight and then the sun comes in, you know, like would be sick.
All right.
Breaks my heart.
Royal House basically started a movement. Okay, so that was Chicago. Now we're going to Detroit now. So this is like a couple of years later. And this is one of the first techno records that I had. It's coming from Mayday, from Derek May.
Oh, mm-hmm.
And
this is like the time when you discovered like the rave scene in Detroit when you were 16 years old?
Yeah, like so that like time? This would have been like even before my time discovering Detroit. Like when I went to Detroit for the first time, it would have been maybe in 94. And when I was going to Detroit, I was going to see Richie Hawtin play. I was going to see like Jack parties, that's what those were called. And like Richie Hawtin was doing some crazy parties there. And that was like mainly the parties that we were going to were those ones. And there was a lot of other stuff going on, but that was sort of like the mega influence for me. And he was sort of the connection to these guys, which is like the Belleville Three, which is Kevin Saunderson, Derek May, yeah, and Juan Atkins. And I sort of, years later, started to discover all that stuff. But this was coming from 1988.
Okay, wow.
It's pretty heavy. But it's amazing how many producers now are imitating the sound that Mayday was doing in the 80s.
In the 80s,
there's,
yeah,
tons of records coming out now that sound the same sort of rawness of these things. Well, they're trying to do it anyway.
They try.
Okay, ready for the next one?
I'm ready. So you joined the Richie Hawtin parties during the time when he was still performing as Plastic Man?
Yeah, I mean, that was really like...
Crazy
That
stuff,
was a
man.
Mega influence on me. Yeah. Big time. Like, so,
yeah,
you know, we were 16 years old, going over, like, really, like, not having really a grasp on what that concept was, you know? Because there was, like I was trying to say before, there was, like, two different things that we were getting influence from.
Mm-hmm.
There was one type of party, like, rave scene thing that was the Toronto thing, which was very much a different thing. It was not different in a bad way, it was just different. And this was really, like, what was going on down there was, like, a raw thing. It was, like, a really... It was an acid thing, basically, to be honest with you. And this would be one... This is another Chicago record, but... This was like, this is what kind of did it for me. And the lights come on, party's over, everybody. You gotta go home.
Okay, ciao.
Police are here, you gotta get out of here. You gotta go. You gotta get out. That would happen sometimes, you know? Sometimes that would happen.
It's really
hard.
Honestly,
I was at one of those parties, Richie Hawtin in handcuffs. He had to get out of there. I'm not kidding. They were like arresting everybody like this. Same, imagine like that kind of thing happened.
Oh my God.
Really?
Horrible.
He's fine now, don't worry, everybody. He's okay. He managed to continue and make more happen.
No, man.
He didn't go to jail in Detroit. It was in Windsor, actually, when that happened. If that's why. If that was Detroit, it would have been a different story.
Okay.
It was actually Windsor.
I can imagine.
Okay, so more acid? Yeah, we're
going
to go for more acid.
Bring it.
Okay,
this is
a hardcore one. Okay, I'm going to make this one quick, just for us.
Really? But
well,
loud.
Okay, listen. You want to hear the whole thing? Showing you the evolution here.
It's
from 1958, here we are still
it's
going.
It's a journey.
This is where we can talk about the...
Okay. make it louder, louder, louder. Come on, Mike.
Yeah.
It's a really
good get
one.
The idea. So yeah. Basically,
I see you raving front row.
Yeah. Well, so when
going
I was
crazy like this,
I'll tell you the really embarrassing thing.
Okay. Oh, and, finally, embarrassing stories.
So here we
I'm
go.
Waiting
so
for this night from the beginning.
My DJ name when I was a kid, when I was, you know, 15, 16, couple years.
Yeah.
Okay. So I had like all my hair shaved off except for like a kind of wushu kung fu ponytail,
it's
like
so
this.
Old school, like Sven Fried.
And my DJ
days,
name
huh?
was the Chemical Kid. That was my DJ. So I just told you now, your like exclusive news story.
Like really,
the
I
Chemical
love it.
Kid.
And you come out with the story like just now, like.
Yes, we've suppressed it with a team of lawyers. We had this story suppressed for years. We had like, anyway.
You know that I will name you like this.
It's an exclusive. It's an exclusive story
exclusive
for you.
Story.
Let's hope somebody does. Anyway, let's see what
my
happens.
My Chemical Kid, huh? Yeah.
So this going on, moving on from to better things.
Okay, better than that.
Disregard everything I just said, and let's move on to the best acid track of all time from Laurent Garnier.
Mm. Don't wrong. Anyways.
That's right.
My ass.
Yeah. I mean, I think for me, like a lot of people would say, okay, what's their favorite acid record of all time? For me, like this ranks pretty, like number, like top three. I would say this is really a genius acid record, for sure. A lot of people would argue, you know, I think that this could be number one for me, just in terms of what this record does for me, how I feel when I listen to it.
Beautiful.
This goes, takes me right back. Move to the next. I'm not working for the label or anything. The label doesn't exist anymore, but it's another one from Fragile Records. That was a major, major one for me, major influence.
But also and the one from Laurent, it's like, sorry to
interrupt yeah, sure,
you, but,
sure.
But it's like a trip for me. You know, it's
such
a masterpiece.
This one is coming from the Advent, and I think for me, this is the best thing that they ever did. And it's the Advent, it's a guy named Cisco and another guy named Colin. Colin is Mr. G.
Yeah, Mr.
He
G.
Was, he was half the other half of the Advent. And these guys are like the true deal, man. This is the real deal. And this has so much power on where I went with music. This is the tempo that it was made to be played at.
Yeah.
I would always play it like minus eight, but this is where it was supposed to be.
Like it's supposed to be. I like it that fast. Can we have more drinks for Mike?
Wow, that's awesome. And when the Advent were playing live back in the day, when these two were playing together, wow, it was so awesome, man. Because like this guy Colin has so much energy on stage. And Cisco was so like in the zone, and the sound quality of their live PA was like hitting you in the chest, like heavy.
Awesome.
Okay, here it is. Ready, ready? Okay, ready. We'll fade out here. Whoa, because it gets even better. Right. Wow. Let's hold off just in case someone's getting a little too hot in here. Let's cool it off.
It's getting hot in here.
But we're not going to cool it off. We're going to make it even hotter. Okay, so we got game one now. And then there's no game two. There's whatever. Everything else is game two. This is game one.
Okay.
For me, in my opinion, I've been trying to imitate this record. I'll just skip ahead here.
You tried to imitate.
I've been trying to get this sound, and I think Orlando Vuorn, for me, everybody loves Juan Atkins. Everyone knows who Juan Atkins is, but you know who Orlando Vuorn is?
Of course.
A lot of people don't know who that is. I think he's one of the most underrated producers from Holland.
Is it like that?
He's a Dutch guy, he's amazing, and I think like this is the proof in the pudding here.
I think I didn't know this one.
You know this track?
I don't think so. I might have heard it.
Yeah, so it's Orlando Vuorn and Juan Atkins together, and I think for me this is one of, I think it would be my favorite, like the most influential techno record that I own is this one. I love this thing.
It's amazing.
This
I love it.
I've been trying to do this since I heard it, and this is what I'm talking about right here. Yes.
Masterpiece.
So yeah, Orlando Vuorn, amazing. He's doing there's a new record that I just heard from him that's coming out on the compact that's really, really cool. And these guys are still doing some amazing music. Kenny Larkin would be the next, next one on my list. Okay, but you gotta excuse me. I can't remember which side it is. So I hope that I've got the right one. This is a compilation, it's not all Kenny. But anyway, I'm looking for the Kenny one.
Yeah, looking for Kenny Larkin.
Anyway, we're gonna play whatever it is that's there. I hope it's Kenny. That's it, that's Kenny. This is like, for me, like one of the quintessential Detroit techno records. I mean, a few of them that I just played for you are, but like our trips to Detroit that I was talking to you about, those were the years. This would have been, you know, 95, I think, maybe. Yeah, 94, 95. The one before that was 94.
It's so timeless.
Timeless.
Yeah.
Again, so many different tech house people imitated this without even realizing it. It all kind of came from records like this. How many more should we do? We could keep going.
Yeah, I could do this for.
Yeah, I know
days,
you could do this for
weeks, ages. But yeah, I would say you choose another final record.
Do you do the last one?
Yeah, then it would be lovely to get some insights of your album we just talked about. So just a few. Yeah. Okay, let's do it.
So let's do one more, right? This one or this?
No, like a final. A final. Time's flying always.
Okay,
when you listen
to
music,
damn.
It's like there's no time.
So yeah.
So then Jeff Mills, well, okay, so we'll go for Jeff Mills for the finale. So this is my favorite Jeff Mills record for sure.
It fits to my
t-shirt. This one also
today.
Had like a... Good final. This one, like a lot of people could agree with me on this, is like the Mills art Humana is like, you know, this is poetry. Just like,
he's a fucking genius, man.
This is like one of the most romantic techno records. Like everything that's there, like all the polyrhythmic stuff that he's doing, and like how warm and it's sort of just how soft and soothing the whole thing, but at the same time it's so driving.
Yeah.
And when you're imagining, like you're listening to this at 115 decibels, this just like brings pure euphoria.
Yeah.
That's what a lot of those like Detroit records did for me, was like instant euphoria on the dance floor like this.
Romantic techno, I think, is the perfect description.
It's a good way to say it, right?
It's a good way to say it, yeah.
All right.
Man, Jeff Mills as a last
Jeff Mills. I mean, hats off to Mills. I mean, that...
Jeff Mills, by the way, here.
I always wanted to meet that girl, too. I don't know why. Still don't know who she is. Still looking for... If you're out there, I'm looking for you.
Okay, okay. Can you...
It's actually a photo of my wife.
Yeah, of course. I mean, I know your wife. She's beautiful, so I can agree.
So there's more techno that we could listen to, but should we listen to more, or how should we do this?
I mean, we're running out the time, unfortunately.
Should we listen to something from the album? We do it like that?
I think, because we talked about it before, and I think it would be nice to show some little insights of the album.
Cool,
because,
okay.
Because like sci-fi, and you never did something like that before, so I think it's
so, yeah, let me leave you with this one. That's just like the end of our evolutionary stage. There's a lot of things that we missed along the way, unfortunately. We couldn't put it all in there. There was quite a few gaps in there. We went from 1958 to 82.
Yeah, there's,
you know,
there,
anyway.
There's but, something in between. Know,
who's
still.
Counting? Who's counting? So I'm going to play you one of my favorite songs from the new album that I'm doing. This one's called Blindside.
Mm-hmm.
That's all, folks.
It's amazing.
I can't wait to show you the whole thing. Anyway, thanks so much for having me do this. This was amazing.
Mike, like, to be honest, I always enjoy so much to hang out with you. It's just lovely to spend time with you. Like really. I'm so thankful to have you here as my guest, wonderful guest. And
Yeah, I'm pretty sure my Discogs folder will explode after today. So, and I'm pretty sure for the people out there, it will be the same. So, yeah, just thank you.
Thanks so much.
Danke an mein Team, die natürlich wie immer herausragende Arbeit geleistet haben. Danke an euch fürs Zuschauen. Ich hoffe, ihr habt das wie immer so genossen wie ich. Und ja, ich freue mich, wenn wir uns das nächste Mal wiedersehen. Und ab morgen könnt ihr dann auch die guten Stücke, die wir hier gehört haben, auf www.warmup.berlin wieder hören und finden und dann hoffentlich auch auf Discogs nachkaufen. Also, bis bald, eure Isabel und euer Mike.
Tschüss.
Tschüss.